is Vera Scroggins, V-E-R-A, then S-C-R-O-G-G-I-N-S. I want to say that I'm from Susquehanna County, and we have pipelines there, hundreds of miles, since 2008 for the gas drilling industry. And in our pipelines, they're using a lot of people who are from out of the area. So I hear a lot of union people here talking about if, a lot of ifs, if they use our labor, are you guaranteed by Williams to be employed? What unions are being guaranteed by Williams to be employed? Because if you look in our county where Williams operates, they use a lot of out-of-area people. And they also use non-union besides union. So unless you're guaranteed, I wouldn't count on it. You'll see the percentage that they will use. And with that, when they use the pipelines and they go through all the wetlands, the streams, the creeks, the areas of water, just like in our county, we've had all kinds of impacts. We've had drill mud releases a number of times in all the waterways, and that impacts the area. They've been fined by the Fish and Boat Commission for the impacts. Are you willing to experience that as they go through your wetlands and your environment? This is not a risk-free operation. You're talking right now, it's a 30-inch pipeline. Some of the pipelines that we have, of course, are smaller even, and now we have the 30-inch, and some are bigger. I would like to say also that with that comes the infrastructure, the additional compressor stations that may be added to this pipeline. When they did a 16-inch in my county and where I live, they told us, the company told us and reassured us that there would be no compressor stations along that line. We asked them a number of times. I was an intervener for that line. I'm an intervener for this line. And then when the pipeline was built, we now have 8 compressor stations on that along that line where they promised us and said there would be none. So it might be very difficult to believe this company as well as other companies. Will they sign it? Will they write it in writing for you? Will they promise that they'll have no compressor stations like they're stating besides the ones that are here now? Get everything in writing, because what they tell you, one thing, is not always what happens later. And with those compressor stations come all kinds of toxic emissions by the tons with each station, besides constant noise for those who are nearby. And did they tell you also what kind of classification is for this pipeline? We are in a rural area just like yourselves. Anything that's 10 homes or less in a linear mile is considered by FERC a Class 1 classification. Class 1 means the least amount of regulations. The more people in an area, the more regulations, the more enforcement, and the more inspections. So what are you classified as? From what I'm seeing, it looks like it's going to be like where I am, Class 1. So you're talking about a 30-inch line. Do you know what kind of impact area if there is a leak and there is an explosion? When you're talking pressures of up to 1,500 pounds per square inch, you're talking about massive pressures here. This is not like suburbia, where they have small lines and small pressure. If that should leak and that should blow, you're talking about miles of an impact area. Now, these lines are going through farms, like I'm hearing, near homes. Just like near me, there is no setback, no minimum setback. I'm not sure what it is here. You may probably have the same thing. No minimum setback. We have lines within 100 feet of homes. We have compressor stations within 400 feet of homes. There's no minimum setback for that either.
Please conclude your comments.
So if anything happens, you're talking about miles of impacts, Are you ready to endure something like that besides the devaluing of your properties, the value of your property? Because who's going to buy something with a 30-inch line going through your area and your towns? Thank you very much.
Good evening, and thanks for the opportunity for me to speak. My name is Craig, C-R-A-I-G, Stevens, S-T-E-V-E-N-S. I'm a sixth-generation landowner in Pennsylvania, Silver Lake Township. My mom's from Oswego. I'm a fifth-generation New Yorker. Here tonight, I think you need to rename this project the unconstitutional pipeline. Thank you very much. There's the Constitution itself. I carry it in my back pocket every day. My dad told it the rule book. Let me read from you Amendment 5, which says, nor be deprived of life, liberty, or property without due process of law, nor shall private property be taken for public use without just compensation. Ask the people that live near the pipeline that blew up in Kentucky that leveled multiple homes what just compensation would be, especially if a family member was life was taken in that. America's fuel. No, folks, we're America's fools. There is 37 import-export terminals in place right now. They're trying to reverse flow because we have to do what? Save Ukraine and Western Europe? How about we start saving ourselves first? Anytime you're competing with a foreign country for the same commodity that we need at our own homes, guess what? The price goes up, folks. And that's a law of supply and demand. Of course, we could look at what's happening to my landowning partners. You know, these wells, these hydrofracked high-volume wells, are lasting about 3 to 5 years of output. The first year alone is up to 70% reduction in its output. Is that what we're selling out for? Is a couple years of fuel out of each well? Because if you think my neighbors are getting rich in Pennsylvania, the fastest moving legislation right now in Pennsylvania is the Royalty Protection Act. Hey, these fools that are coming here telling us they're going to make us all kind of money don't even know how to pay people on a legal contract, and they're getting their rear end sued off to where we're at. Environmental impact statement. Let's look at the constitutional impact statement for a moment. Suspending operations for import. There is no such thing as imported natural gas. But they're setting up export. Now, I asked the Constitution Pipeline people in Williams last year when you're doing the scoping hearings directly on camera if they know where this gas is going and if they can assure me it's not going overseas. Guess what? They said, we don't know where it goes after Albany. Well, if you just go on their website, you can see under key points, one of the highlighted items is LNG exports on their own website, guys. You know, is this thing on for? Are you listening to me? They can't even trip over their own lies. That's what they're doing. Please, they abuse us as landowners. The pipeline that went across my property, we were assured, and I have the legal document here showing they're supposed to put in erosion and sediment control, not harm the environment. Well, guess what? They got found guilty by not one, but two agencies in Pennsylvania, Fish and Boat and DEP, that they violated their own agreement with me. And guess what? They fined them $20,000 after filing 5 criminal complaints. Now, that wasn't Williams, but Williams now owns that pipeline. And by the way, if you guys are from Williams, come up to my property and tell me how you're going to clean up the mess left behind by your predecessors. Hey, they spent $150 million to put that pipeline in. And you know what they sold it for to Williams? Laser did? $750 million. By the way, they only gave $350 million in cash, $450 million in stock. So the same guys that ran that pipeline across my property and destroyed my property doing it are major shareholders in the company that wants to do this. And don't even let me get started on Cabot. I got documents right here from our own state DEP saying they contaminated the water of 19 of my neighbors. That's the documents from the DEP. And hundreds more that were released last year, documents showing massive water contamination. Be careful what you ask for, New York. You might get it. Come down and see what's really going on and talk to real landowners that care about private property rights and civil rights and ask these people, who are you kidding? They've been allowed for the last 2 years, Williams, to go around to these local communities and give out grants, quote-unquote. Millions of dollars of grants. Thank your grants. We've had enough of your buy-off money in eastern Pennsylvania. We're not interested anymore in the tailpipe, as Eddie Murphy said in Beverly Hills Cop. We don't need your gas. You know why? If it's going to come out of my backyard, let us use it here. Why did our propane prices go up 3 times higher than last year just in the last 90 days? They reversed the flow of that pipeline that you probably let them steal by eminent domain. Instead of coming up with propane, they're sending all of ours down. We are a third world extraction colony. And hey, all you guys in the orange shirts back there hoping for jobs? Yeah, be careful what you're asking for. Some of the jobs I've seen are not very fun. Secondly, make them guarantee you jobs, and any job will be short-term. And for the landowners, say no to this and say no fast. They'll offer a few bucks a foot, and they'll steal it lifetime. I will, in saying that, guess what? When they're making billions of dollars sending that gas through your property that they stole by eminent domain and paid you a few bucks and cut down all the trees in the pipeline route, you're going to get pennies. Wake up and figure out a different way to do this, because I need energy, but I need clean water, and I need my civil rights a lot more than they need my land for a pipeline. Thank you.
Hello there, thank you. Is this the one? Thank you for holding these hearings. The last name is H-U-S-T-O-N. I just want to say that I've really been following this for quite some time, and just as a point of reference, there were actually in the spectra, I want to call it the resistance group, because it's really a massive group based in New York City that was involved in the spectra pipeline resistance. They were able to achieve, I think, 600 interveners prior to the Spectra docket. The largest number of interveners in any FERC docket was 35. They filed 5,000 comments. Many of them were substantive. And the pipeline is in the ground, and it's in service. So I question exactly, is this going to have any effect? Maybe it's just like it's a big show. It's to channel our energies into a theater where we don't have any agency. But regardless of that, we are still gathered here because we want to believe that this process might have an impact. So I'm just going to point out a couple of issues about the application and also the draft EIS. And I want to echo all the other people that said that this is like laughable, and the clear bias is obvious for anybody that looks at the draft EIS. I'll give you an example. I made a video about this, and basically the question is, what's the start of the Constitution Pipeline? And it's really curious, because when you ask Williams employees, you actually get three different answers. You get half the time they'll say, yes, it is the start. The Williams Central Station is the start of the Constitution Pipeline in Brooklyn Township, Pennsylvania, Susquehanna County. Let's say a third of the time they say that. Another third of the time they'll say no. Williams Central Station, that's a completely separate project. And then the other third of the time is really bizarre, because they'll say yes and no. They'll say yes, well, it is the start of the Constitution, but it's not part of the Constitution. And I just do like a face palm at that point. I'm like, what? It's the beginning, but it's not part. Okay. And I noticed that FERC has adopted this scheme, because FERC calls it a related but non-jurisdictional facility. Huh. Okay. It's related but non-jurisdictional. Curiously, the draft environmental impact statement actually lists that there's three compressor stations that are going to be at the beginning of this pipeline. And one of them is in New Milford, PA, where we're going to be all on Thursday. And it's double. I mean, I've flown over Williams Central Station, and it's massive. And it's just, I think it's four engines. This one in New Milford, I haven't seen it yet, but it's 8 engines. It's big. Let's go back to Williams Central Station. Does Williams Central Station have any environmental impacts? Well, it turns out it does. It has a lot. 98,000 801 tons per year. 98,801 tons per year. This is a train car loaded with coal 10 miles long. That's the environmental impact of just one of the three compressor stations at the beginning of this activity. Does the draft environmental impact statement recognize any of the impacts of the initial compressors? Well, it does, and it says these impacts can be estimated, but curiously, it doesn't go about any calculations or any estimates of what those environmental impacts are. The other thing is that the environmental impacts of the draft EIS only take into account the environmental impacts of the pipeline itself. So what's really strange about this is it kind of like just omits or maybe forgets about what's being transported in the pipeline. Is there any environmental impact of the gas in the pipeline? 650 decatherms per day? So I did some initial calculations. I'm going to wrap up, but I just want to say this last point. I just did some calculations to figure out what is, because somebody asked me this months ago, and it really has taken me months to figure this out. So I'm going to tell you and all of you today the result of this calculation. The question is, how many gas wells in Susquehanna County is required to keep the Constitution Pipeline at 650,000 decatherms per day? Does the draft document look at that or ask that question? No. Hold on, this is really important. So,
30 seconds, Mr. Easton. Please, 30 seconds, he's done.
Tell them to give me time.
You're wasting your time. 30 seconds.
Listen, this is an important question that is not in the draft EIS. You should be asking this question, not me. The answer is, initially, 110 new wells and 80 new wells per year. I want you to ask my friends, Craig and Vera, that's double Cabot's production in Pennsylvania. Cabot's activities in Susquehanna County is going to double for the Constitution Pipeline. And there's already been drastic impacts. You people are rude. Thank you. I'm done.
Hello, RAYLEWIS. First of all, I would like to disclose that I am also a proud union member, and I can relate very well to their concerns about jobs. Well, what's interesting is almost all of the support tonight has revolved around job creation. Now, I'll come back to that in a moment. We all know that the wording eminent domain is purely sugarcoating for stealing. All right, I'm going to repeat that. We all know that the word for eminent domain is stealing. This is America, and not one job, not one single job should ever be created by stealing anyone's property. Thank you.
Hey, have a nice evening. Good luck, buddy.
Michael M.P.
Michael M.P., common spelling Michael, M.P., E-M-P-E-Y. Boy, this is difficult. You know, the three things that I'm hearing here, I think I can just bring down to a few elements, and that's economics, environment, and then eminent domain has been spoken here so many times this evening. And I think that as I've traveled around the country, and I've been in Colorado, I've been in Wyoming, I've been in North Dakota, I've been in Montana, and I've seen this gas development follow me around the country, I can say that, it's like a Monty game. I think that the environment and the people are always the losers in this game. It always seems to be a stacked deck for the production companies. Now, I think that, you know, talking about the Constitution pipeline and the environmental aspects of it also has to include a looking at these other elements as well, particularly the economics. Now, it's not a real energy policy behind the shale gas, and I would like to offer some quotations, not of my own, but they're from an industry expert, and if you give me just a moment, I'll just look at this. This is an Arthur Berman, and this is found on oilprice.com, and this was an interview with him. He is a geological consultant with 34 years of experience in petroleum exploration production. He is currently consulting for several EMP companies and capital groups in the energy sector. He frequently gives keynote addresses for investment conferences and is interviewed about energy topics on television, radio, and national print and web publications, including CNBC, CNN, Platts Energy Week, BNN, Bloomberg, Platts Financial Times, and the New York Times. Now, some of the quotes in this extensive interview were just mind-opening to me anyway. And I'd like to have an open mind, but I don't have an open mind to the point that my brain's going to fall out. So I'm looking at this, I think, fairly. So, quote, recently the CEO of a major oil company told the Houston Chronicle that the shale revolution is only the first inning of a nine-inning game. I guess he must have lost track of the score while waiting for in line for hot dogs, because production growth in the United States and U.S. shale gas plays, excluding the Marcellus, is approaching zero. Growth in the Bakken and Eagle Ford has fallen from 33% in mid-2011 to 7% in late 2013. Oil companies have to make a big deal about shale plays because that is all that is left in the world. Let's face it, these are truly awful reservoir rocks, and that is why we waited until all the more attractive opportunities were exhausted before developing them. It is completely unreasonable to expect better performance from bad reservoirs than from better reservoirs. Quote, production from shale gas is not a revolution, it is a retirement party. Quote, the shale gas boom is not a sustainable, except at higher gas prices in the United States, which we've all suspect and believe anyway. Investors have tolerated a lot of cheerleading about shale gas over the years, but I don't think this is going to last. Quote, taken together, the U.S. needs to replace 19 billion cubic feet per day each year to maintain production at flat levels. That's almost four Barnett shale plays at full production each year. So you can see how hard it will be to sustain gas production. Then there are all the efforts to use it up faster. Natural gas vehicles, exports to Mexico, LNG exports, closing coal and nuclear plants, so it only gets harder. This winter, things have begun to unravel. Comparative gas storage inventories are near their 2003 low. Sure, weather is the main factor, but that's always the case. The simple truth is that supply has not been able to adequately meet winter demand this year, period. Say what you want about why, but it's a fact that is not inconsistent with the fairy tales we continue to hear about cheap, abundant gas forever. Because of high decline rates, new wells must constantly be drilled to maintain production. Shale plays will last for years, not decades. I expect by the time that all the construction is completed to allow gas export, the domestic price will be high enough to not to bother. It amazes me that the geniuses behind gas export assume that the business conditions that resulted in the price benefit overseas will remain static until they finish building export facilities, and that the competition will simply stand by when the awesome Americans bring gas to their markets. The U.S. acts like we are some kind of natural gas superstar because of shale gas. Has anyone looked at how the U.S. stacks up next to Russia, Iran, and Qatar for natural gas reserves? Everyone agrees that oil and gas will cost more if we allow exports.
Please conclude your comments.
That's all I have. Thank you.
Martha.
Thanks for hearing us today. My name is Colleen McKinney, C-O-L-L-E-E-N-M-C-K-I-N-N-E-Y. I didn't expect to speak tonight, so I'm reading on my phone. Many people say we need this pipeline because it will bring jobs to upstate New York. According to 4.9.1 population and employment of the DEIS, during the 8-month construction period of the Constitution Pipeline, quote, approximately 75% of the total workforce would be non-local. It also says that most of those jobs would be the higher skilled, higher paying jobs. That's in the DEIS. Again, quoting the DEIS, assuming the construction workforce comprises a maximum of 1,300 individuals, this project would generate at most 325 temporary local jobs during the 8-month construction period. I did the math here because it wasn't included, 325 jobs. Quoting further, an estimated 7 new full-time local employees would be directly hired to operate the facilities on a permanent basis. And I'll repeat that. According to the DEIS, Constitution Pipeline would create 7 full-time local jobs.
7.
Yeah. The reality is that this pipeline will cause a net loss of jobs once it's in the ground. In the short term, it would be good for 325 people here, and those other 925 people from out of state would be a boon to bars, motels, fast food chains, walk-in emergency clinics, and I'm sad to say prostitution. It is well documented that these are the businesses that profit from the workers of pipelines and fracking infrastructure build-out. In less than a year, however, these temporary out-of-state employees will be gone. Those 325 temporary local jobs will be gone, and 7 lucky people might have permanent jobs. The Catskills and Southern Tier are tourist destinations and farming communities. A high-pressure gas pipeline and the fracking that would inevitably follow would condemn this region to an economic fate far worse than it has ever seen. Here is only a partial list of current revenue-building industries that would be threatened by this pipeline and fracking. Trout fishing, hunting, bed and breakfasts, campgrounds, canoe rentals, restaurants, dairies, beef cattle operations, vegetable farms, apple orchards and berry growers, breweries, cider makers and distilleries, cheese makers, yogurt factories, garden centers and landscape businesses, equestrian centers and stables, retreat centers, caterers, farmers markets, colleges and universities, technical schools. These relatively small businesses may seem inconsequential when compared to a large out-of-state company such as Constitution Pipeline. Collectively, however, these businesses, many of them independent, are the foundation of our region's economy and are responsible for a significant amount of its revenue. These small businesses represent the work of many local people, positively affecting our economy, our environment, and the general public's impression of the Catskills and Southern Tier. They care about what happens, these businesses do, to our air, water, and landscape. We who live far out in the country, like me, will never be able to hook into natural gas. We're too remote to make it financially feasible to run lines to us. People who live in villages along the pipeline may be able to access gas, but only after they pay a hefty fee to run a line from their house to the municipal line, a fee that often runs in the thousands. Should a homeowner decide to take the gamble and pay to tap in, who is to say that gas prices will stay low? In fact, Constitution Pipeline Company has reported to its investors that it will be exporting its fracked gas to Canada and other places out of this country. There, it will command a high price, and here we will have less and less gas. It will become more expensive. Homeowners will be stuck with a new form of heating, fuel that ends up being more costly than what they formerly had. Our region will be home to a high pressure, highly potentially explosive gas pipeline, which is not great for attracting tourists or students. And Constitution and its shareholders will see great profits. Does this seem like a fair trade-off? Thank you.
Hello. Thank you for having these hearings. In 2008, I came to Schoharie and purchased some land, a beautiful watershed. I did some investigation on building, and there's quite a lot of logistics in terms of having a certificate of occupancy in a house. You need to have a septic system, and there are a lot of rules. So the fact that they're actually putting a pipeline, which has high chemicals to both build it and transport it through it at high pressure, is laughable. And so I'm here not only to speak for the damage to my land and to the area surrounding it, but my neighbors in New York City, where I'm from. We have about 20 million people who depend on the watershed to drink. And when we start to put high-pressure gas, which has chemicals, this land shifts. I noticed when I opened up a shed door that the door wasn't open because the land shifted and the foundation wasn't enough footing. It was a small shed, so no big deal, but the pipe will move. On the way over here, I spoke to a guy who's in the construction field, and he said that, yes, this pipe will shift. And there will be computerized ways to make sure that if there are any leaks, that it will be shut down and isolated and fixed. But in the meantime, that has takes oxygen out of the soil and has contaminated the groundwater, which will eventually run off. In addition, run off downstream to where we all drink our water down in New York City and many other watersheds surrounding in Pennsylvania, in the Delaware, and in New Jersey, and all. I mean, this is pristine land, beautiful land. And I've heard from a lot of people who say, okay, well, it's going to affect the farm, it's going to affect my school, it's going to affect these children, but it's going to affect the metropolitan New York area. This is a lot about politics, I believe. The gas, is, as a lot of people say, is not an infinite supply, and to be able to, and the desire for energy independence is even more interesting now because of what's happened with Russia taking over the Ukraine, and we're not wanting their natural gas. So politics say, put down pipelines so we can have energy independence. Well, obviously, we're hearing a lot about how this natural gas is being going to be shipped overseas. And not only that, we're also hearing that, you know, it's an unlimited supply. The fact that they're going back to the leaks, I'm just speaking off the cuff. I don't have exactly something that I wrote down, but there, throughout this, we're talking about the draft, DEIS, and it's always, throughout it, it's talking about how it's going to minimize the environmental impact. Well, that means there is going to be a major impact that they're just trying to minimize. And over time, there's going to be corrosion to these pipes once it's buried. And as I say, the shifting and any kind of small leaks, it becomes cumulative. Not only that, but they're talking about low-flying airplanes to spray herbicides to kill the vegetation surrounding the pipeline to stop roots and stuff from destroying that the pipeline. Well, that's going to have a problem with air quality. I mean, personally, I have a desire to have a organic farm and permaculture farm, which is basically, and I really feel for all the workers here, who, you know, but the jobs are short-lived, and there are many other ways for energy. Geothermal, which is also digging underground to put circulating for more energy. The other thing I will have to say is that the amount of electricity that we need is extreme, of course, but there are other ways. If we had high voltage and low amperage, as Tesla once discussed, we could actually have, you know, huge energy from just the air, just from tachyon energy and things of that nature that should be researched. All the science says that there is no that we have to get off fossil fuels, because what's happening is with this. I'll say one final thing, that the this 1 pound methane is equal to 80 pounds of CO2, which goes into our air and contributes to global warming. I'm sorry, my name is Mark Wishengrad, MarkWishengrad. I didn't say that at the beginning. I'm saying it now, and I don't think that this makes sense. This pipeline, putting natural gas, is nothing natural about it. It's pollutants, and there's chemicals within that, benzene and methane, and it'll have a ill effect on the groundwater. And when you lose your water supply, we can't drink. It takes care of the air and the water. Thank you.
Thank you. DEBORAHKROL. I am a landowner and full-time resident of Schoharie County. This is tyranny, not democracy. If the FERC approves this pipeline, you are enabling a large corporation to seize and take our property, not for the benefit of Americans, but for the benefit of this corporation's bottom line. The fossil fuel industry has turned into a monstrous tyrant. You may not have noticed that over 210 municipalities in this state has adopted legislation which opposes fracking. New Yorkers are standing up to defend and protect our families and this beautiful, clean environment. I thank Governors Patterson and Cuomo for stalling, because reports of disasters surrounding this industry far outweigh the jobs that it promises. The latest being the birth defects in the children of mothers living near a frack well site. We know about the blowouts because we witnessed the destruction of the ecosystem in the Gulf of Mexico, and the 9 square mile aquifer in Dimock, Pennsylvania, that was forever contaminated because of spills, accidents, and 3 faulty wells during shale gas development. Cabot paid those families off to silence them and make them go away so they can keep up the lie. This industry is willfully ignoring the evidence and warnings from experts like the engineer and fracturing mechanics scholar Anthony Ingrafia, who says 5% of well casings fail upon initial well drilling, or that 50% of concrete casings will fail within 30 years. It won't be long before contaminants from frack fluid like benzene and toluene will be showing up in all the drinking water wherever this industry exists and where the aquifers extend. Incidentally, ExxonMobil is buying up water rights all over this planet. Imagine a future where this tyrant controls the world's drinking water. Ecologist and biochemist Bob Horworth warns of the fugitive emissions of methane released into the atmosphere during production, storage, processing, along pipelines, venting, and at compressor stations. Methane is a serious global warming contributor. Yes, it's been a cold winter, but it hasn't stopped the glaciers in Greenland from melting at alarming speed. The cases of asthma, lung cancer, headaches, brain tumors, nosebleeds, skin rashes, nerve disorders. The radon exposure alone from the Marcellus shale gas will likely kill 80 people per year in New York City. Those that used to hunt for game in Pennsylvania say the deer from that state have cancerous tumors when you cut into them, because they are attracted to and drink the frack waste in open holding ponds. New Yorkers will not be sacrificed for the benefit of this industry. We don't want your injection disposal wells causing earthquakes, your radioactive solid waste, your chemical-laden hazardous liquid brine, and this damn pipeline, which is at the heart of this madness, this greed for profits above and beyond all human decency. These people should be behind bars, not allowed to plunder and destroy our resources, deplete and contaminate our fresh water in the name of business. Cabot, Williams, Piedmont, ExxonMobil, Shell, Chevron, government officials on the take, and everyone duped by the promises of this industry, open your eyes, we don't want your business go away.